So I want to introduce our next speaker, and it's from the Law Enforcement Action Partnership, also known as LEAP. LEAP is an organization of current and former police, judges, prosecutors, and other criminal justice professionals who use their expertise to advance sensible drug policy and criminal justice solutions that would actually enhance public safety. Our next speaker is Dr. Paul Larsen, the founder of LEAP in Scandinavia, speaking to us from Norway. His presentation is entitled Drugs and Punishment in an Exceptional Country. Welcome, Dr. Larsen.
Thank you. As mentioned, I'm a professor in criminology and also one of the founding members of LEAP in Norway. So what I'm going to speak about is drugs and prisons in Norway. And it was very nice to listen to the previous speakers, see that we in Norway actually have something positive to export. That's a very good thing. Norway and the Scandinavian countries are often presented as exceptional countries. And that's why it's called, why I talk about exceptionalism, because it was pointed out by criminologist John Pratt that we were an exception when it came to the development in the Western world concerning prisons. And this exception is described in this way, and it's pointing out the Norwegian justice system focuses on the principles of restoration to justice and rehabilitation of prisoners. The humanistic ideals, of course, that is sort of in the bottom of all this. And the Norwegian prison system also, we have a very short prison sentences. The average prison sentence in Norway is like 198 days. So that's the average sentence. But what I'm going to speak about today is one of the exceptions from exceptionalism. It's about the drugs, because even if we're liberal people in Norway and a sort of a positive you know, short sentences and so on, we are hawks when it comes to drugs. And the drug policy in Norway is rather un-Scandinavian in many ways. We have very long prison sentences when it comes to the drug field. And we also have quite harsh measures. And this, of course, affects also life inside prisons. And it affects how the police works and the whole justice system. Because, as I said, 198 days on average, that's rather short compared to most other countries. But when it comes to drugs in general, the average is 302 days. But when it comes to what we call aggravated drug cases, and I think in the US those would be considered as small drug cases, most of them, we have the average is like 796 days. So it's 800 days. It's more than the double. It's actually four times the average. So what you see, of course, is that you have some that get exceptionally long prison sentences. We also brag about the very low recidivism rates. Norway is a low crime country, so a rather peaceful corner of the planet. We also like to consider our prison system the best in the world. And we're not alone in having that view. CNN has been here, Guardian, BBC, and so on. So a lot of reports from Norwegian prison systems, and it's all often presented as the world's nicest prison. That's in Norway. We are in Halden, a small prison there. It's the world's most humane prison, if you ask the Guardian. This might be true. So is this discussion also in the Nordic countries? Where are we really that exceptional? Or is this what's in the bottom here? And we can see that actually in some ways we are exceptional, but in others we are not that good. When it comes to incarceration, we have incarcerated 57 per 100,000 in Norway. When compared to the U.S., as we also saw in the previous presentation, that's nearly 10 times as many in the U.S. in average. So we're more in line with the other Nordic countries and also Netherlands and Germany to a certain extent. While the U.K. is higher, and it's always been like that. And when it comes to the prison system, of course, there's big differences between the prisons. And this is very important to point out, because most of the prisons we have are open prisons now. But we also have, of course, high security prisons and locked prisons. So there's very big differences when we actually talk about the prisons and also how nice they are for the inmates and how they work. We also have a policy that said that we should not incarcerate any person under 18. So I think that's very, very rarely, at least in Norway now, any prisoners that are younger than 18, you find it. But the rule is try to keep them out. You can ask, why actually do we have this ideology and why do we have this way of this humane thinking about prisons? I think the main thing is that since we have rather short sentences, we know that all of the prisoners are coming back to society. they return to society, and we have to actually make them better able to live a good life in society. And you don't do that by locking up people and throwing away the key, as they used to say in the old days. As I said, when it comes to drugs, both in Norway and Sweden, we are usually zero tolerance towards drugs. That's also in the prisons. But it has started to move away and started during the mid-80s because of the AIDS epidemics. And we had to do something to try to get control of the spread of the disease. So I think today in society in Norway, we have another way of looking upon drugs, try to minimize the damage. So it's a damage reduction. While inside the prisons, there are still the old way of thinking at zero tolerance. The sentences, as I mentioned in starting, is quite long for drug crimes. It's maximum up to 21 years imprisonment for drug-related crimes. Of course, that is rarely used, but you see it once in a while. And that is for smuggling or big quanta, selling or big quanta, of course, those types of crimes. Approximately 30% of the inmates are on drug convictions, and a high proportion of the inmates have drug-related problems. I should also mention that the biggest problem, of course, when it comes to this is alcohol. It's more than 50% of inmates in Norway has been reported as having alcohol-related problems, and many of those also have drug problems. So it's a As you often see when you start to do research on prisons, you see that the problems are often complex. And it's not only one part, it's not only the drugs, but mainly it's often alcohol, which is a starting point. The treatment of drugs inside of the prisons have changed quite a lot for the last decades. And today, the ideology of empowerment is the most important way of trying to solve and trying to better the quality of the life of drug users. So empowerment, of course, means that try to help the inmates to better tackle the life outside, help to build a better way of living. This, of course, is done in many different ways. And then, of course, if you study inmates in Norway, it's just the same as in the US and in other countries. They often have social problems. They often have health-related problems. They often have, as you heard in the earlier presentations here, problems with mental illness and so on and so on. Often you find them also without work. They have problems from schooling and so on and so on. So when you start to tackle the problems also of drug use, you can see that it's usually part of a big complex. It's not only the drugs. The drugs are often the end of the line in many ways. And then you can ask, is the prisons the right place to try to solve a lot of these problems? Well, a lot of these problems can't be solved inside prisons, but of course you can make the prisoners better suited to meet the life outside by actually often learning and giving them better ways of reacting and so on and so on. So it's quite different things. This is often done then in drug counseling units, which are established in some of the prisons. It's only like 3 or 4% of the inmates in Norway that has this possibility to go to such a unit. So this is not a thing that you find out through the whole system. I guess that most of those units will also work best when it's more open prison systems, not the closed, high security and so on. And as said, inside the prison, you have a zero tolerance towards drugs. And that means, of course, that it's also a lot of testing of the prisoners. And it's also a lot of control about drug use and so on. But at the same time, it's like in any other prison around the world, you have quite heavy use of drugs inside the prison system. And on top of that, of course, there's heavy medication. So many of the inmates have different problems and use sleeping pills and so on. So this is well known. So you have the illegal drugs and the legal drugs. It must be said that these drug counseling units are quite popular among the inmates, because when you are on such a unit, you get a lot of extra freedom. You get also, you can go outside in society and you can go to cinema, you can do many things. And they have also quite a few resources, and they are also much more heavily staffed than in a normal prison. This also, that means that they're actually very expensive to run. So these are not cheap units. It will cost a lot because you have psychologists working there, social workers being there, and also, of course, ordinary prison staff. Studies of these drug counseling units have shown that it's very wide variations in how they work and what they actually do. In some prisons, you don't have enough resources to make them work well. This is often one of the problems. So you find in the practical use of these units that they vary quite a lot. Some of them are quite well working and popular among the inmates, while others are seen more as running on too little resources and not really reaching their goals in a good way. Then I can ask the question, and I will end with this slide, so you get some time to ask me questions. I hope I can answer. You can ask, of course, the question if Norway and Sweden are that exceptional and still exceptional, because there's quite a few things that are problematic also in the use of prisons in our society. We have been criticized quite a lot because our use of isolation in the Norwegian prison system. So isolation is, of course, and it's been pointed out many times that we should reduce the use of it from studies done by international organs that work with these things. One of the reasons is that we have quite a few on remand, in remand prisons, that's actually not sentenced, and usually they often sit in total isolation. We also have a problem with parents in prison that is often pointed out, and this doesn't work well. We have an unproportionally long sentencing in drug cases, as you've seen, and this sort of ends. And many of those also sentenced in drug cases, it has to be pointed out that we start to get quite a few foreigners in Norwegian prisons. It varies between 25 and a little bit more than 30% of our prisoners are actually foreigners. It must also be pointed out, and it's the same old story, that also quite a growing proportion is also sons and daughters of immigrants. So we have a sort of situation that we didn't used to have some years ago. The inside Norwegian prisons used to be very white, but today it's not. You see variation. You see that Norway has immigration. You see also, especially from Eastern European countries, quite a few offenders. And it's always like this. Even if we use prison as a last resort, it's often the hard end of the system where the hopeless often ends up. And as I mentioned earlier, these are persons with many different problems. So to help them, of course, to treat them, to rehabilitate persons that have a long life of actually failure and deep social problems, that's not an easy thing. And to put them in prison, it's maybe the last thing you should do. And also in Norway, even if we're one of the richest countries on the planet, it's also here cutting back of money going to the prison system. And the big question is if we still can afford to have institutions like this working this way, because they are very costly. So treatment is one of the first thing I usually cut in, so at least in some of the prisons. And then another point, of course, is that the prison itself is based on conflicting ideals. First of all, if you ask what's in the bottom of the Norwegian system, it's first of all that we should incapacitate and think security. And inside the system, we're quite obsessed by security. At the same time, the system should empower and be human. Is it possible to have both of those things going on at the same time? You can ask that question if that really works. And just to end up the whole thing, I would say that even if Norwegian prisons are presented as nice and a good place to be, and we have very good ideals behind what we're doing, there's no problem with the Norwegian ideals. But the basic thing is that the pains of imprisonment are still there. The boredom is there. It's to be locked up. Prison is not a good place to be, even in Norway. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Do we have any questions in the audience for Dr. Larsen? That was an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
I have a question that was written by Glenn Love. I'll go ahead and ask the question for him. He wonders, the harsh sentencing that you mentioned for drugs, he's curious as to which ones, and are medical uses allowed for pot, psychedelics, etc.?
You ask inside the prison?
This is how he worded it. I assume in society.
Actually, there was a drug reform that was on its way in Norway, but it was torpedoed. And that drug reform was opening up for decriminalization of the use of drugs and possession. But it was not going through in Parliament. So we actually have it's not legal to use. But there are some experiments and some use in medical use of it's not LSD, but it's other psychedelics, actually. But it's very, very little. So it's we're not an open society for such things, no.
Thank you.
Look at your phone.
It looks like Dave Flattery has a question in the chat, but I also see a hand up from Santa Barbara. So I don't know, Dave, if that's you or someone else.
This is Dave. Yeah, I'll just reiterate the question from the chat. Yeah, I wondered, and I think this was partially answered, if in Norway mental illness in criminals is treated any differently. Is there, are they diverted into some other system for treatment, or is that handled in the normal prison system?
We have a system. If you are found to be mentally ill, in some cases, of course, the sentence gets shorter and you get treatment. But yeah, might also if you're seen as mentally ill but dangerous, and there will be problems with recidivism to dangerous crimes, then you can get a special sentence for that. That is actually more or less without any time limits on it, because you have to be go through a court case. You have to be checked and see if your mental state is still the same. You know, so this is actually more or less without time limits. Yeah.
Are there any other questions?
Thank you, Dr. Larson. I just wanted to say, I just wanted to thank you for your hard work on this. And I was just in Oslo about a month ago, so beautiful country. So it was awesome.
We have time for just another question or so. Would anyone like to chime in at this point? We have 3 or 4 minutes.
One from Joyce.
Okay.
Go ahead, Joyce.
Oh, thanks. I just wondered if you were aware of Michael Moore's treatment of the prisons in Norway in his movie, What Country to Invade Next? And was that a pretty accurate presentation? Or as you say, it was very much in the minority of what is going on there.
Actually, haven't seen it. I've seen some of his films, but not this. So thanks for the tip. I will check it out.
And I see Gail. Gail has a question. She has her hand raised.
Gail, go
ahead.
Yeah,
I was just wondering, I have a former son-in-law and some other people that I know that in the United States they've had issues with drugs, and they have been put into a hospital, but as soon as they get out, they're just out, and it just means that, you know, for the time they were in the hospital, they didn't do any drugs. So they're still needing treatment. And the day they get out, they're doing their drugs again. In Norway, is there supervision as you step out of the system that is helping you, or are you just dumped like we do?
Well, it used to be just the way you describe also in Norway. It used to be that when you were out, you get $50 in your pocket and a plastic bag, you know, and ended back up on the street. And I think at least there's been a lot of attention towards it. So I actually don't know what the real status of it is today. I hope the probation is doing something, but I can't give you a good answer, because this is one of the things I haven't looked into for a while. But I know it used to be like that in Norway also. It's you know, you were clean and nice, and you go back to nothing. You go back to the street, and then you're on again. That's it's a good old way. Yeah.
Thank you.
Let's all give a big hand of a round of applause, like so, to
Thank you, Dr. Larson.
Thank you.